What's up, everyone? Welcome to Old School Tuesday Turnup with Miss Watley. That's what I'm talking about. Yes, welcome back for another 90s interview. You know what? I'm not going to hold you guys longer because I know you guys are dying to hear what this guy, this brother, has to say. Y'all, show some love to the one, the only. I'm talking about Mr. Damion Hall. What's up, Damion? How are you tonight?
What's up, man? I'm doing well on this Tuesday, just here waiting to get down with you and see what we got and what we're gonna be talking about, you know what I'm saying? And welcome myself to all your fans and everybody that, man, who's been really supporting you for this last year. It's a good thing, and I'm just happy to be here.
Thank you. You know, Damion, I'm gonna go ahead and go right into it. I love your personality. I'll be seeing you on social media. You always dancing. You be just having fun, enjoying yourself. But this is something I noticed. What is one thing that your fans does not know about you?
What's something that my fans don't know about me? I think most of my fans don't know that, you know, behind the scenes, I have been the glue to all things Guy, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, when people saw Guy break up and come back, mm-hmm. that's because of the nights and the conversations and the toil that I've been going through to make sure that these two cats, Teddy and Aaron, realize that, you know, we are mm-hmm. special with one another. So I think, and also they don't know that I design a lot of the outfits, you know, 75 to 80% of the outfits, that the ideas of them came from my brain. And I also choreographed all the mm-hmm. shows when Guy started in 88, 89. That was with me and my late brother, God bless, Sheikh. And we really went hard in the paint. You know, he gave me the understanding of that I could be the dancer that I am today. So I think most of my fans don't know that.
Mm. Now, you said design, you said outfits. Is there one outfit you said you ever look back on and like, be like, what was I really thinking? But then at the end, you're like, you know what? I'm glad I did that outfit. Is there ever one specific outfit you can think of that you're glad you did do?
Nah, you know, I mean, I love the fact that the ideas, along with, you know, Keith Holman and Dapper Dan helped us out when we first came out. Dapper Dan, you know, did mm-hmm. some stuff for us, and Keith Holman did a lot of stuff. I don't have any regrets for anything that I ever came up with, because it's because of Guy that a lot of these artists have the fashion and you know, the jewelry, the fashion, the swag. We started a lot of that, period. If it wasn't for Guy, you wouldn't mm-hmm. even seen that. You know, it's from the jumpers, to the silks and the rayon, mm-hmm. to the jean and leather match stuff, mm-hmm. and the same fabrics and the different fabrics being interwoven within one another. You know what I'm saying? With the mm-hmm. glasses and the shades inside the club, with the canes and the fedoras. We did everything. We did everything mm-hmm. across the board, and most people had one look. We had numerous looks, and all looks represented the swag of the GUI.
Mm. So was there, since you designed it, did you get any help? Did you see other boy groups from the past, from the 60s and the 70s, you know, that help you, you know, out with your fashion, you know, that you sit there and you like, I'm gonna take from them and put it towards us. And did you ever take from any other boy group from the past to help you with that? Or
nah, I mean, what boy groups can you go with? New Edition, they was suited mm-hmm. doing what they did, you know what I'm saying? Before mm-hmm. then, I wasn't into groups like that. So I didn't look at anybody else, because I was a church boy. I was a church boy, right, doing church things and praising mm-hmm. God and reading the Bible every day and doing martial arts. Like, for me, it's just like mm-hmm. dance. I never took a dance lesson, but my mm-hmm. brother gave me the belief and watching him move, like, you know, seeing round and round video, you know, that was my brother, those two cats, you know, Kevin and Shake. Mm-hmm. They mm-hmm. inspired me to be as great as I could have been as a dancer in this group. And so I never looked toward anybody else to get my vision. Like, everything came from my head, because, you know, I think it's cool to be copycat, right? Don't get me wrong. Some people can go back to the 30s and the 40s, take a suit, change it up, change the lapel, move and stuff. But I just didn't do that. I think the style of the past is better than the present anyway. Everything circles around each other, right? But in order to be different, you have to dig into yourself. And if you see anything Guy wore, we were different. We were different, especially for that time. And the acts that came behind us, you know, really followed that trend. You know, the Father MCs and various different acts. They followed our trend, and which is cool. It's flattering because we all were just going hard in the paint at that time.
Now you did. There's something you just said that you know, I want to say an ass. You said you were a church boy. Now I know artists of the past, they suffered a lot leaving a church and going into art. You know, coming straight into R&B. Did you have any backlash with that? You know, anyone from the church?
Nah, because I don't. You know, my life wasn't predicated on what somebody else may think of me. The only people I cared about was my mom and my dad, and what they thought. And at first, they didn't want me to leave college. So there was more on them. It was more about, you're leaving college to do what? To go and sing? And, you know, my dad gave me the permission to do it. And I did it because I wanted to help my brother. So I never felt any transgressions and stuff for leaving the church, because the church was always in my heart. It's still in my heart, though I don't go to church anymore. Like I don't wake up on Sundays and go to church. But the church is in my heart, and I still read the word. And without God, there is nothing anyway. That's just the fact. So for me, it was all about being who I am and being true to who I am. And so I felt true. And, you know, we got to where we got because all three of us doing what we did together.
That's what I'm talking about. Yes, yes, yes. Now, I'm going to go ahead. There's an important question. And I've been asked, someone asked me, they want to know this answer. You guys did all kinds of music, from Peace of My Love to, I mean, all those hit songs. But the song Peace of My Love, look, I know someone, my lieutenant, she wants to know, you already know what I'm about to ask you. In the lyrics, they want to know, are you saying dumb B, are you saying dumb B as the word, the B word itself? Are you saying dub B, like do you be, you know, H-E? What are you, they just wanna know, what are you really saying? What are you guys really saying in that lyric?
Well, here's the thing. The Peace of My Love became classic and became this huge song because people thought we said, I don't know if I can cuss on your joint, so I'll say
you
dumb
can do
B
whatever
where you say. Okay, because they thought we was calling girls bitches. We really wasn't. It was a single, zombie baby. You know, so it was like a thing. And but you can't tell. It's like folklore at this point. You know, you can't tell somebody, no, I slowed it up and I heard it say dumb B. And I'm like, okay, well, if you heard it, then that's you hearing it. But we didn't say it, right? And I'm thanking God for the folklore, because if it wasn't for that, I don't think the song would have been as big. I think it's because people heard that in they self, in their subconscious, and it flew across the world with, oh man, Guy saying dumb bitch, da da da. It made the song bigger than it probably would have been. I mean, the song is a great song, but if you listen to the lyrics, for all the women fans that you have on your joint, if you listen to the lyrics, you know, it. it can almost be like, you gotta be half-assed to flow with these lyrics of what these cats are saying. But I always say we was being true to what guys wish that they could say. We just sung it, right? It's like you can't have all of me because I'm not totally free. You can't, right? So we're already telling you, if I give you me, you're only gonna get a piece of me. Because 3/4 of me belong to this woman over here. So you can have a piece of my love, but you can't have it all, right? And how many cats can say that and get away with it? Guy got away with it because it was way it was sung. It was my brother's vocal. It was the beat. Like everything grabbed you before you can even think about what we were really saying. And by the time you thought about it, you already loved it. And you was like, well, shit, look how they dress. Look how cool they are. Look how he's down. Look how he danced. Look at Teddy's cute little face. Like, you automatically, you fell in love with the threesome without understanding that, you know, we really wasn't trying to fall in love with you at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. Well, her question got answered for her and her dude. And it was my other coworker. She's younger. And her generation was still talking about it. I'm like, wow, just to know people still think this is what they're really saying in a song. It just goes to show you how much, you know, music is like, and we sitting really talking about it last week. And I'm like, you know what? She was like, don't forget to ask. I'm like, I'm going to make sure your question gets asked. I got you. Cause I hope she's watching. I know she is, but you just answer her question. So I'm pretty sure she's happy. So, what would you say? What are the most essential ingredients to making a love song?
Well, first of all, you have to have been in love before, right? You have to, mm-hmm. and then you also have to be hurt before, not just in love, but you also have to have felt hurt and pain, you know, to have given it and to have felt it. And once you can, mm-hmm. you can feel pain, especially mm-hmm. from a woman's point of view, is very easy for you to write about it, because you hurt her. And why did you hurt her? Was it necessary to hurt her? Was it necessary to be rude? Was it necessary to say the things that you said so harshly? And how did you feel deep inside yourself, being true to yourself? How did you feel? Did it hurt you when you said it? Do you wish your pride had fallen and you had said, you know, sorry faster or forgive me faster? So when you have all these things going on at one time, if you really pay attention to yourself, it's easy to put pen to paper and to say sorry. And it's all about what words you put together to give that sorry and to what melody you put it. So whenever I write a song, I'm always writing about what I feel a woman needs and wants. Sometimes it's not even what I give, it's what I feel she should have and how she should be treated. And I put pen to paper. Sometimes I might not even be the person acting that way. I might not be like, oh, I'm ready to fall in love and get married, but I can write about it because I know mm-hmm. what it feel like to want to be loved and want to be appreciated and want to be cared for and taken care of in a way where it's not about anybody else except that one person. And I can go into that world and write about it. And sometimes it's almost like a helpmate for me to understand what it is to really give love and to accept it. A lot of us don't know how to accept love because we're afraid to be vulnerable. So I always, in my writing, when I'm doing music, I always allow myself to be vulnerable.
Yes, yes, I like that. And for everyone tuning in, hello to everyone who's tuning in. I see all your comments. I wanted to say hello to everybody. We got people in here, Damion, Beth, Perry says, great interview. George Perrier said, hello, Damion. Everybody saying hello to you, Damion. So they're loving the interview. I just want to say hello to the Howard girls. I know you guys are watching. Now, Damion, now I know when it comes to a love song, next comes making a music video. We've been showing music videos right now. My question is to you, what kind of, when you're doing a music video, what's the concept of the music video? Like, how you want to do your music video? Like, how long does it take on average just to make a music video? And what's your concept, like, how you want to do it?
Well, when I write a song mm-hmm. and a song and music and concept of visual comes almost simultaneous for me. Every artist don't mm-hmm. work the same way. But because I can write and I can produce my own music, and because of the producers that I work with, when I choose to work with other producers who know me, everything comes simultaneous. So when I'm writing a lyric, I'm actually mm-hmm. seeing a visual of that lyric. And it's all about how you want to present yourself and how you want to present somebody else who's your co-actor or your significant pieces inside your video, be it a car, be it a woman, be it a building, be it a specific place. You have to visualize yourself and how you think that would allow your audience to fall in love with you or to understand you at that point. And so for me, it all comes simultaneously. I'll use the dog me out video, that concept was mine. A couple of video concepts from the guy concept was mine. But dog me out remix video was my concept. And when I heard dog in me, why you dog? I automatically saw us doing this, you know, with the dancers. Hey, 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 boom, boom, and us walking into a club and us doing certain things. And Aaron having the dogs, the Rottweilers, and all three of us having Rottweilers. Aaron had Rottweiler during that time, a Rottweiler named Sam. I actually saw this within my mind when the remix was done. You know, I did also design the outfits that the girls wore, the dancers wore in that video. You know, so for me, everything comes simultaneously. Like I kind of get what I want people to see, and 9 times out of 10, what I want people to see, I think, because I just believe in myself this way, that the majority of people, that 9 out of 10 people that see it, are gonna say, "Damn, D, that was a hell of a good visual." So you know, but I'm very confident in myself and all things that I do. So it's you know, when I work with, even if I work with a co-director or someone that I'm bouncing off my vision to, even when I'm working with them, it comes to a complete understanding of, this is what I want to do. I want to run through this wall. When I come through the wall, I'm in some place different. Like whatever but it's all about the song. It's all about the drive of the song. If it's a dance song, you know, I can be dancing on the moon or dancing in the club or dancing on top of a car. It all depends on what the vibe is, right? So visuals are my thing. Everybody that know me know visuals are my thing, you know what I'm saying? And I love visual. I think it's the visual that allow you to get caught up in the artist. Without a visual, you don't say, "Oh my God, he got a house like that, he got a car like that, he got girls like that, he wear jewelry like that." You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, everything is perception when you're first coming out, right? And some of us have allowed our perception to become our reality, right? So it's all about what it is you're trying to present. And when I present, you know, especially when I come out with something new, I present clothes, sound, visual, everything has to be presented on a silver platter for my audience.
You got talent. That's talent. And I get exactly what you're saying. You could kind of like see if you're writing, you can see it right there in your head. I totally get it. I get it. But you got one question. Alicia Preston wants to know, one of my favorite movies you were in, New Jack City. She wants to know, how was it for you doing the New Jack City movie?
It was great because it was our first real movie, right? During that time, we had did New York Undercover. We were still artists of New York Undercover. And then we got New Jack City. And really the time that me, Aaron, and Teddy spent in the studio doing that song, "This is a town, grab your partner and get down." When we came up with that song with Bernard Bell and us, and you just heard the boom, 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 you kind of knew that was going to be the vibe for the essence. And for us, for it to be such a great thing, when Wesley and them was coming through the club, it was a beautiful thing that our song and that we was capable of being in that scene as well. So I truly loved it because it was the first, you know, that was a huge underground hit movie for Black America in itself, right? And for us to be part of that, creating the New Jack Swing sound and creating the New Jack City song, I think it was phenomenal because to this day people always go, "Yo, that scene was the you know," it's like, I'm like, "Thank you."
Yes.
Yeah, it really brought us, we were really brought together at that time. We were very close, me, Aaron, and Teddy. We really enjoyed, life was great at that time. Things were moving fast. And like, I don't think we could do any wrong at that point. And it was beautiful to be with Mario Van Peebles and Wesley. Me and Wesley was boys during that time. And Tracy, who played his girl, that was my homegirl during that time. It was just a beautiful thing. You know, Al Payne and everybody, we all was real close. So it was like being around family. So I really enjoyed it. And it really took us to another level. It took our celebrity up a couple of notches. Major notches. Mm-hmm.
Yes, because that I think actually I was watching it this summer, and I think it was on the Tubi app. And I don't watch New Jack City probably over 30 freaking times. And you guys are in a yellow outfit. Nino comes in, yo, Nino, and here's these guys, Guy. And they say you guys' name, Aaron, Teddy, Damien. And you guys start dancing. Dun, 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 dun. Yeah. And I was like, that's a classic movie. That whole scene, the dance scene. And you have Flavor Flav in there. Oh, man, it was, oh my God, that movie is just classic. And oh my goodness, I could just imagine just being amongst, like you said, all those people, all those legends, Christopher Williams, Ice-T, oh my goodness gracious. And then, you know, Vanessa Williams, that's a movie you really can't touch. You can't remake. You know how they remake a movie? That's a movie you can't remake it. You can't touch it. You can't do anything to it but just let it be, because it was classic. It was perfect. It was just perfect. Yeah. Everything about it was perfect. Yeah. So when you out on tour, how do you decide your set list? And first, how do you decide your set list when you're out on tour? How do you know what songs to go first and last when you're out and performing on stage?
Well, for us, you know, that happens way before we get on the road. Me and Teddy normally are the ones, you know, I'll put my set list together, he'll put a set list together, and we'll go back and forth with each other. So basically, because I put the show together in regards to choreographing what we should do, when we should do what I should do, where I should be, where Aaron should be. Me and Teddy usually go back and forth with that. And 9 times out of 10, he goes with my set list, because I really know what the audience is used to seeing and what they want to hear. I mean, and it's really not hard for us, because not being on no, you know, ego thing, but there's very few songs we have that are not, you don't want to hear all the way through. Right. And we only use 16 on the road. So I kind of know you hit them with your first thing, which usually is Groove Me. We'll come out, but we do a couple of things before that. And we come with Groove Me as the first main song. And then we flow with maybe 1, 2, 3 up tempos, because people don't ever sit down doing our show. 3 up tempos. And then we hit them with ballads. Then we go to a medley, then we go back into a ballad, into our up-tempo, ending out with up-tempos. So, you know, for us, Guy is a groove group anyway. Like, we, you know, we keep you, and even when we get to the ballads, you just like, man, you just want to sing along, you want to get down with it, because you got Peace of My Love, Goodbye Love, Let's Chill, Aaron Throws and I Miss You, we have Tease Me Tonight, Smile. We just hit you in the head with all the true bangers that we know are gonna keep people interested in staying on their feet, because there's very few groups that can keep a whole 40,000, 50,000 people on their feet from beginning to the end. Very few artists can do that. We do it all the time, and I'm thankful for that, because that is very hard to be able to do. But you know, you have three different types of personalities, so I think our fans, when they come to see Guy, different people are coming to see the one or the three, right? You see the three, but you have your favorite. You know, people go, I'm coming to see Teddy. Some people come to see Aaron. Some people come to see Damien. And because they come to see all of us, it encompasses different personalities and different vibes. And so, you know, I might get Teddy's fan to become my fan. He gets my fan to become his fan based on what we do on that stage. You know, but I'm the energy. I always describe, tell people, I'm the energy, Aaron's the voice, and Teddy's the music. And without one of those three, it's difficult to get the Guy vibe. You know, I call us Voltron. You know what I'm saying? We connect each other, boom. And when we get together, you know, it's a hard force. It's hard to beat that monster. You know what I'm saying? Because our music and our vibe is really one of a kind, and it's really hard to you know, you can't stop us. You gotta come hard when you come on stage with Guy. You have to. You have no choice.
Yes, yes. Now, speaking of tour, What has been the craziest things that happened to you on tour? The weirdest, the craziest, the borderline thing a fan has ever done since you, when you go out on tour?
I mean, the craziest thing a fan has ever done, and now and to this day, I don't know how they did it, is come up the side of a hotel and knock on my window to my room. How they find out what room I was in, how did they climb that Spider-Man they ass up that wall? I do not know. But it was a lot of at that time it was like air conditioning units, so maybe they stopped. I don't know how they did it. But listen, I had no choice but to let her in, because at the end of the day, I did not want this girl dying. Oh, for the sake of wanting to be with Damion. Who knows what room she thought, but I know she knew it was one of our rooms. So maybe she thought she was knocking on Aaron's window or Teddy's window. Or maybe she wanted to knock on my window, but I let her in. And you know, it was what it was. But that was the craziest thing that ever happened on tour as far as, you know, the wild stuff that goes down. You know what I mean? It's a lot of stories I can say, but... That's the wildest, because I don't know how she scaled that bill.
Not the old air conditioners.
Yeah,
what
yeah.
Was she thinking?
Maybe she climbed up like, you know, please. I don't know, but I was not going to let her die out that window.
You ever had panties thrown to you on stage? The most weird. Have you ever had panties thrown to you on stage while you perform? You're like, what these big draws doing up here? Like, they ever happened to you?
Yeah, I mean, I've had panties thrown on the stage. You know what I'm saying? I've had mom, and I had a lot of wild events, man. Like we, you know, and there's many artists that can have their stories, man. I had many wild events, man. Look, I realize no matter how handsome or how ugly you are in this business, songs are amazing, right? Songs can make people do anything. I'm talking about male and female, but I'll stick on the female side. Songs can make you fantasize about the wildest shit you ever wanted to fantasize about. And I'm amazed at that. Like, I'm like, why do you love me so much? I love Groovy, I love Piece of My Love, or I love Round and Round a Lot, or whatever song it is, and you say, you love me that much that you are willing to do what it is we about to do right now. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And that's why I always tell artists, you have to learn how to take the S off your chest and let the lights go down. Because if you don't, you'll always live in this, and this is my word, fantastical mindset, where you was born and everybody treats you this way. That's not the truth, right? Mm-hmm. People don't know you to want you like that. They're just happy to be touching you because they think that you are so much better than them. And I don't ever say somebody is less than me or me. It takes a lot to be Damion, because I've paved the way and went hard to be who I am right now, right? But I also don't put myself above anybody in that aspect. I do know I'm different. I do know I was born different. But if everybody was to tap into their talent, if everybody could tap on a glass, but hello, okay, my talent is acting. My talent is drawing art. My talent is making clothes. My talent is speaking. My talent is loving, just giving hugs. If people can really tap into their God self, you'll be amazed how many people can just look one up to you and just want to be and give you love just for you being as great as you are and your gift. But unfortunately, it's not like that. And unfortunately, a lot of artists, they stay connected to their fame. I kind of unplug mine when it's time to unplug, because if I don't unplug it, I probably can be like that too. And, you know, I don't want to talk to you. Who are you? Why are you up talking to me? And I never wanted to live my life like that. So I did. So, you know, some artists say, Damion, you allow yourself to be too connected to fans at times. And I can say, yeah, sometimes that's true. But I also say I don't regret allowing the fan to understand that without them, there'll be no me. But you can never disrespect me. I just don't allow no one to disrespect me. You can't disrespect me. Me as a man in general, and then me as Damion Hall, Crazy Legs, whatever you want to call it, what I've done in this industry. I will never let nobody disrespect what me, Evan, and Teddy have brought forth to music. And so, but I think my fans and my people understand me that way. They accept me, and they know how I carry Guy on my back. And they also know, for those that know me individually, they also know the pedigree of the king that I am. So I don't really play the games, and I don't really downplay nobody. It is what it is. You know what I'm saying? My music speaks for itself. My videos speak for themselves. My show speaks for itself. And if you ever meet me one-on-one, my character speaks for itself. So it's up to you to judge that or not judge it. I don't really care about somebody's opinion on me. But it's up to you to take that how you take it.
Right. I feel you on that. I definitely get what you were saying. Some people, some artists do, they kind of like forget who they are. You should never forget who you are and where you come from. Because I always say, you can see an artist on top, and one day, the next day, they're no longer on top. That's it, you know? But always don't sit up here and act like you're better than someone else. Because, no, everyone, treat people to, you know, basically how you want to be treated. So that's what I say about, you know, on that opinion, you know, for myself. So what keeps Damion Hall performing? What keeps you performing?
The people. Like, it's the people. Like, you know, I'm seeing certain videos being seen on your platform right now. People, you know, like, want to get with you. I did that whole video. The clothes, the direction of it, the choreography, everything, along with my brother Shay. When it comes to car, I did all of that. That was my concept. And that whole concept came out of my head. I went to LA. I thought about it, what I wanted, where I wanted to shoot, everything. And it came off the way that you see. For me, it's all about being true to yourself, man, and not overthinking yourself. You know, some people overthink themselves. Like, you really not that singer, homeboy. Stop acting like you sing better. My brother sing better than you, who's not famous. Well, yeah, you got 10 million records. Woo, woo. I'm just saying in general, it's like, but a lot of artists, no disrespect, because I'm not going to say names. A lot of artists are not as talented as you may deem them to be, or because you see them so much on different platforms and different things. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of no names that can sing and perform better, but won't get the opportunity to be seen. You know, for me, the fans, after 37 years, 3 albums, but we haven't had an album out since 2000, and it's now 21 years later, and people still want to see Guy, and people still want to see Guy headline tours. That's the only reason why I do it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I love performing. I love performing. I don't particularly like singing, even though I sing and I'm doing a new album and all this other stuff. But I love performing. I love being able to get people to be in a certain zone or mindset when they see me, Aaron, or Teddy on that stage. And if I'm on stage by myself, I want you to be in a mindset where you're like, what is he going to do that's different than what I hear off his record or streaming now, what I streamed yesterday? What is he going to do? And when you see it, I love captivating you, or seeing if I can captivate you to be in another zone, you know, to move and jump up or sit down or cry or want me right when I want you to want me, not when you want to want me, when I want you to want me, right? That takes skill to be able to do that. That's why you have certain artists that you see perform and you go, okay, he didn't look good, but he sounded good. It's all right. And then you see other artists, you like, woo! Like, when you can't wait to see a Keith Sweat or a New Edition or a Guy or Beyonce or Rihanna. Like, you like, I'm going to see a show. Because you're going to see a show. You're going to see something different than what you hear on a record. Right? It's because we know what we are doing. Mary J, she knows what she's doing. Fantasia, she knows what she's doing. You know, Erykah Badu, Jill Scott. I'm only naming people that I love watching on stage. I don't really like watching a lot of artists on stage, because a lot of them really, really don't know how to perform. And for me, you know, but those that do know how to, Charlie Wilson, go on and on. And I, because I'm not naming certain names, don't mean, Pamela, I don't, you know, that. I'm just saying, you in order for you to be great, to be A-list, it has to be something different than just getting on stage, standing there singing your song. I'm like, I can stay home and do that. That's why, you know, the pandemic made it very easy for people to go, I'm not going to the concert. I'm gonna stay home, and if I choose to, I'll log in, right? It's like why Versus is so great right now, because people are seeing certain nostalgia artists go with each other. And I don't even look at a lot of stuff as competition. I look at it as giving each other respect. And then you get to choose who you like or what you like. Mm-hmm. Or if you love both of them because they respected each other during the whole time. But for me, as an artist, you can't dress in the clothes you wore all day and then come on stage, you have them same clothes on. That's garbage to me. To me. Mm-hmm. You have to give the audience something else. And I love to give you something else. And, you know, and if I don't, I'll go and I'll revamp my shit and come back and be like, okay, I'm sorry, I was asleep. No one's ever said that yet. But, you know, I'm a real critic about how to present yourself when you're on that stage as an artist. I think as an artist, you gotta give these fans. If it wasn't for y'all, we wouldn't be where we are. I still wouldn't be here. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be on the show if it wasn't for the fans. You know what I'm saying? There would be no reason to have me speaking on your platform. For what? I'm doing nothing. He's nothing. He looks like shit. He sound like shit. He dressed like nobody cares about him. But, you know, there's something that I'm doing right still, you know, that's allowing people to still want to know what Damion Hall is doing in his life.
Yeah. Like, for me, when I had told you earlier before we came in here, I said I was listening to you on Clubhouse, and I was in there listening to what you had to say and everything. And I was like, no, Damion, I like him because he's real. He tells the truth. And there was something you did say in that chat when we was in Clubhouse. You were like, I remember you saying something about, well, you know what? I'm going to say this. There's some people who should be out in the front, and there should be some people who should not be out in the front that should be in the back. There's some people who should be performing like you said. And some people who should not. And I think with artists, they tend to forget it. You know, when you're on stage, yeah, you really have to perform. So if we out here spending, someone like me, $200 or $300, and I'm come to your concert or come watch you, give your all. Don't half-ass a show or whatever, and then get off stage. Or better yet, I really don't like this when an artist shows up late, and I'm like really? Do you know what people like us have to go through just to take off work or get a babysitter? I don't have any kids. But, you know, I'm talking about the average person, right? Or go get the hair, makeup done, nails done, and get an outfit. Go to, you know how it is at a concert. When you get there, what you have to go do? Go pay for parking, go almost $10 on parking. Then you got to go find your seats. And then you got to sit there. If there's a halftime, go to concession, get a drink, pay money, all that. So average people like me, we're almost spending out almost $1,000 for someone who wants to be on stage an hour and a half, 2 hours. It's like, really? But let's mind you, that artist decides, oh, I'm going to show up late. For what? Why would you do that to your fans who sit here and supported you? That means supporting me back. I'm not talking about now, digital wise. I'm talking about back in the day wise.
Yeah.
I'm talking about back then, like when you supported artists and bought like CDs and everything like that. When you have to actually go buy a record, not iTunes, you go buy a song for $1.29 and everything. Is that me? That must be you.
That's not me.
I hear something.
Yeah, that's not me either. I don't know where that's coming from. I'm sorry. I thought that was somebody calling y'all's phone.
Nah, because mine's on do not disturb on purpose.
Yeah, and my phone is good. You think it's the YouTube streaming? No, it's not, man. You guys, hold on. Give us a minute. I hear it, but I don't know where it just come in from.
I don't know where it's coming from.
It's not me.
Let's figure out where this is. Hold on 1 second. Let's figure out where this is coming from.
We got time.
It's all good. What's up, people?
Yeah.
It's the internet, y'all. I don't know why. It's the internet. Bear with us.
Well, okay, it stopped. Okay. There you go. Okay, no, we're back, everyone. Okay, we're back. But no, like I was saying,
repeat
though,
the question, and like, then repeat the question, because some people may not have been able to hear it, Priscilla. Repeat that thought, and so that way people can pick back up, because it seemed like the stream is going in and out on YouTube. So for the ones on the back end, I know y'all gonna be like, Tallboy, it's not working. I am recording the show still, so y'all can go back and watch the replay if it does go out. So just bear with us. I'm trying to work behind the scenes as we go. So, but we are still recording to where the show is still going to be active, and you can still see all of the responses. All right.
Yes. So my question was basically to Damion, what keeps Damion Hall performing? He answered while the streaming was off, but we was actually sitting here. I was telling him how I heard him at Clubhouse, and you know, and I when you sit there and say some people should not be in front and some people are, and some artists should be in the back. And I explained to you when you say about performing, when you go to, you know, some people go on stage, they're not really performing. They're not performing artists. They're just sitting there basically, I'm going to go on stage, do what I want to do, be late, and then leave. I feel like you can't do that. You don't do that to fans who have supported you from day one. That's why I was saying we go out and buy an artist's song. Back then, remember CDs? We'll go to Walmart, buy a CD for like damn near $20, 13 songs on it. Now you can go digital, go to iTunes. So don't sit up here and, oh, I'm going to be late to my concert and then show up, but I'm going to give an hour and a half show. But I done spent almost $600 on trying to come see you. Like, I don't like that. That's why I don't really go too much to concert. If you get, Damion, if you get what I'm saying, I'm just backing up what you said from my point of view.
Here it is at the end of the day is this. Mm-hmm. You know, some people you can't help if they show up late because plane might have happened, anything could happen. But when you get on that stage, you show and prove how you get down, right? Plain and simple. Mm-hmm. And it's important that, because I've learned that the fans will forgive anything that an artist do. Literally, anything that an artist do if an artist give them what they came to see. Plain and simple. But if you step on that stage and you look wrinkled, your stomach is all out, you out of shape, your vocals is off, and you trying to say, well, da-da-da, man, people getting up there walking out, right? And for me, I just believe that all artists, I know a lot of no-name artists and known artists who are phenomenal. Like you really want to see them perform. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, if I see a show with the Izzy Brothers, Frankie Beverly and Maze, the OJs, I'm gonna go see that show, because not only am I gonna hear, but I'm gonna hear some of the best musicians out, and the crowd's gonna be partying, they're gonna be vibing. I believe in shows like that. I believe that if you are just a crooner and you're just a vocalist, don't try to perform. Sit at a piano or play a guitar or be at a mic and just sing. Luther Vandross wasn't no dancer. Luther Vandross, God bless his soul, was one of the most prolific singers, period. But that man could sing. So the mic loved Luther's voice. He knew how to sing. And certain people should just sing, moving. And you ain't really trying to be moving around and making yourself look awkward. I think artists sometimes, because they feel pressure, they do things that they know they shouldn't be doing because it's not really part of their personality. And that's where they mess up at. That's where you start seeing the kinks in their armor. Like for me, I don't do anything I can't do. I'm just not going to do it. You're not going to hear me trying to do riffs all over the place. That's not what I do. I leave that to my brother. I'm a tone person. So when you hear me sing, you're hearing tone. You're hearing that quality of voice. I'm not trying to do something that I can't do. I don't sing like Tank and Brian McKnight. And I sing like Damion. But I can outperform some of the best performers because I know how to perform. That's the difference. So, you know, just, you know, love your fans, respect your fans, and they will continue to respect you. And I love my fans. All the new Jack Swing guy fans out there, I love y'all to no end, because if it wasn't for y'all, I wouldn't be able to do the things I'm doing right now. So thank you for loving the guy music, loving Damion Hall with the Straight to the Point album. And thank you for coming with me through my journey of becoming this movie star I'm going to become.
Yes, yes. Now, there is something you did say while we were off streaming. You said something about the verses. When are we going to, I really want to see Guy do verses with a group like Jodeci, 112, Jacket, Edge, Tony Tone, Boys to Men, After 7, One, you know, all those groups. Would you consider if they did like a 90s boy group verse battle, would you consider doing that with all those other boy groups?
Well, I wouldn't do it with no other group except Jodeci. The rest of those groups, no disrespect, I'm not gonna do a guy with a 112. You would almost. Hello?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm back.
Yeah, if you listen to Jodeci's first album, listen to Guy's first album, and you didn't know Guy or you didn't know them, and you just listen, you'd be like, yo, these two groups are killer. And they can go back and forth with us. And I would only do a versus with a group that can really go back and forth. And that's no disrespect to 112, Next, Tony, none of that. You know what I'm saying? I think I'm good at placing who against who, but you know, Guy and Jodeci is the tennis match. It's the ball over the net, ball over the net. You know, you play Stay, Sorry I Left You, and then you play Tease Me Tonight or Smile. Mm-hmm. That's a hit. You know what I'm saying? You play The Phone Doesn't Ring Anymore, and then you play I Like or Round and Round. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's a back and forth of nothing but flyness. Like, and they came in and literally, because we broke up at that time in 1990, they took the torch and kept running with it. And I believe that if they had stayed, you know, on point with each other and we didn't come back, they could have erased Guy from a certain portion of the industry. But because Guy was so great, and then Jodeci didn't do what they should have done and could have done, and keeping it going, we took the torch back. But literally, that's the only group that I give credence to, and I love all the other groups. I love them. But in regards to a versus, no, it's only Guy and Jodeci. You know, the rest of them they can go forth. And I think Tony, and a mid condition would be kind of dope. You know what I'm saying? I believe that Next and 112 would be kind of dope. You know what I mean? You gotta put groups against the groups that came out with that same type of vibe and structure. You can't put them against a guy, because it's you just can't. And again, everybody know me. Guy is up here for me, and that's no disrespect to any other group. But Guy's up here with me, and in order for me to put a group on that level, I got to put a group on that level that I feel, Damon Hall feel, could slap Guy in the face, and Jodeci slapped us in the face, and that's because we were separated at the time, but they still slapped us in the face. Like I said, I can't put an album with the Guy first album that's classic. I can't put 112's album, Next album. Tony is a whole vibe. I that's one of the only groups when I came in. New Edition, Tony are the groups that I like. Whoa, they were killer to me. Like, God dang, Raphael and Dwayne, all of them cats playing, and they play. And New Edition, and they moves, and that's our modern day Temptations. You know what I'm saying? And you just couldn't bother those two groups as far as I'm. But that's saying. So when Guy came. Mm-hmm. It's hard to sit there and put some other group on Guy's level. You can't just do that. You just can't throw any group on Guy's level. I'm sorry. So the group that I put on our level was Jodeci. and is jealousy, because they really took it and came hard with it. And when Casey and JoJo, with that vocal, with, you know, Dalvin and Devontae's swing, right? Swing, Devontae swing? And we think they got that from? Where do you think they got their vibe from? They got it from Teddy, got it from God. And then they took it and did something they own, because the voices were different. And Casey and JoJo's voices, because they come from a quartet background, church background, brought something different to the beats that they were bringing in. The same way Aaron's voice brought something different to that New Jack Swing movement that Teddy came with, you know what I'm saying? And that vibe, it brought something different. So, you know, and all you have to be understanding that. So, you know, that's a long story that I would do a versus. I told Swiss and Timbaland. Teddy told them also verbally. I told them during DM, because they didn't answer my shit. You know what I mean? But Teddy told them, seriously, like, yo, we do it. We want to do it with Joseph. And that's what it is. So that's that.
Well, I hope it really, yes, I hope it really does happen. There's a lot of fans who want it. Wants to see Guy and Jodeci. That would be a one heck of a verse battle right there. I'm gonna be right there watching for you, because that's gonna be epic. That's gonna be legendary, classic. I mean, it gets no better than that. That's what verses is about. Put groups together and let people like me relive that kind of music. Just want to sit there and listen to it, jam to it, dance to it. That's what it's all about, having fun, just having fun. So I hope that if you guys don't get to do it this year, hopefully you guys can do it next year. I'm gonna be right there supporting. So, but listen, you have been in, of course, New Jack City, and I know this weekend you had the premiere of your new movie, Blindsiding. Did I say it right? Blindsiding?
Blinding Light.
Blinding light. And yes, you have been in all these movies. Now let me ask you, if they were to come ask you to come make the Guy movie, how would you want your story told? How would you want that movie told?
Hey, truthfully, first and foremost, and you would have to go back to me being in college and what I was doing in college, so you can understand the transition from me coming in college to me leaving the group and me coming and being the third member. Now, Timmy, before anybody in the public realm heard any song or saw any visual, but he was in the group nonetheless before I came in, right? So you would have to go in that story, that beginning story as well, and then come into my story being in Virginia State, and then move forward with how me, Aaron, and Teddy really started formulating the look and the sound and the cohesiveness of the threesome. It would have to be told truthfully, and it would have to be somebody to play my role in the beginning. But I can damn sure, and from 30 and up, I'll die this, do what I do, wait, let this get back great, and play my part. I don't think nobody can play me better than me, because I act my ass off. So I don't think anybody can play me better than me, but the version of Damion up until 20 something would have to be played by somebody else for sure.
Would you go with someone would you go with a well-known, or someone that's, you know, underrated? Would you go with someone who's already out, or go with a well-known to play you in your later years?
No, it would have to be me playing me in my later years, because I can still play me. I am me and I can act. So it's different. If I couldn't act, then I would say, oh no, have somebody else play me, but I'm an actor. I was an actor first before I was anything. So, like I said, from 18 to 30, 35 or 30, you can have somebody else play me. But from that point on, I can literally cut this off, have this down, and I'll still look like I looked in my pictures, to be honest and truthful. The difference is I'm a little bit more, you know, I'm bigger, quote unquote, slim than I was back then. But even if they up until the age of 35, then somebody play me up to that point and then step right in. But like, that look like me, and that just follow me and study me. Because there's a certain vibe that Damion brought to the table that wasn't there before Damion stepped in. So, you know, if I wasn't an actor, I would say, yo, find the right thing. Like, you know, Lorenz Tate, or, you know, I don't know. I'm just saying that for now, but it would have to be somebody that could really understand my essence and my truth. Because the difference in me and somebody is I live in my truth at all times. And that's not something that you act. I literally live in my truth. And I know me better than anybody. But again, a casting agent, whoever's casting, they might not want Damion. They might want somebody else. So, and if that, I wouldn't fight that fight, but I'd have to be there and say yes, hey, to whoever, you know, or be part of that picking up who plays me for sure. Cause I don't want that being played in no weird way. You know what I'm saying? It ain't nothing. You got to play Damion and his truth from being a church boy, just really wanting to live for God 24/7 to really not being in the street and not being around a bunch of girls and trying to, you know, have sex all like this to becoming someone who picked up some of that street shit and who became some form of a woman, you know what I'm saying? And God, that became part of who I was, but you got to play that right. Is another way. It's not like I'm disrespecting, but it just became part of my. It was my vice. I wasn't into drugs and alcohol and these different weird things. I was into women, big time, and that became a drug for me. So you have to really understand where I am today.
Okay. Now the movie that just came out. What interests you to do this movie? What was the what drew you into the storyline? What really drew you into really being this movie?
You know, nothing really drew me in. Funny enough, I just was, you know, I was like, this is what I do. Mm-hmm. I'm starting from the beginning again. I can't take for granted because I'm Damon off a guy. I'm gonna get movies, and so I had shot two movies already. I shot one in L.A. and I shot one in Minneapolis. And the one in LA really reached, that was with Mark Casey. It really took me and made me have to reach into this father. I had different emotions I went through with that movie. And I said, I need to get some movies underneath my belt now. So people, almost like trying to fast forward, trying to fast track what I wish I was doing in the beginning. But I have no regrets. So when Sherelle with Amazing Cultures on IG, AH Amazing Cultures on IG did my fedoras, I said, yo, I want a fedora. You gotta bless me with a fedora. She also said that, well, you know, I'm producing a movie too that we're about to shoot. I'm like, when you shoot next week? I'm like, well, I act. Send me a script. They literally sent me a script. Asked me to do an audition. I did the audition and I got the part within 24 hours. Now, I didn't know that the part was going to be such an intricate part in the movie, but it's an intricate part in the movie, and I'm from the beginning to the end of the movie. And all of my movies so far that I've done, I'm into the end of the movie. And that's hard to start now. In the movie game. I don't care if it's independent or feature. So I love acting. For those that know me know, that is my passion. Singing is not my passion. Acting is my passion. I love it. I want to be whoever it is I'm playing. And I want to prove to myself, first of all, and then prove to the director, and then prove to the producers, and then prove to the fans that you're not seeing Damion, but you're seeing whoever that character is. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I strive for. So, you know, now my goal before the end of the year is to be in the ear of the known producers of like Raising Kanan, Power Book 2, P-Valley, Queen Sugar, Insecure. Like I need to get BMF, I need to get a feature in one of those or all of those. You know what I mean? That's where I'm headed right now. I know that if I get the opportunity, I'm going to kill it. I don't know how to disrespect myself, and I will never disrespect somebody that gives me the opportunity to be in their script and read their thoughts of what it is they are trying to portray in the characterization of who they have created in this film. And so I really respect acting even more so than I respect my singing. Like I truly love acting. If I had acted first, I would already be an A-list actor. Ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about that. The same way with Guy, you know, when Guy came out, everybody told us we wasn't good. And now look at us now. You know, we became the top R&B group, period. And, you know, and that don't happen all the time. And the same way with acting. You give me the opportunity, I'll show you that you didn't take a risk, that you actually, you know, this is something good for you too. Just because I believe in myself. I love acting. And I will fight to the end to be on a set with a Jamie Foxx, a Will Smith, a Denzel Washington, Angela Bassett, a Kevin Hart. You know, I can go on with people naming names, but you know, let me be in one of those films. Let me be in a film with Al Pacino or somebody and watch. You know what I'm saying? I'm not gonna complain. I don't care what the part is. I'm just, you're gonna see somebody that really knows what you're doing. Cause I study myself. Like I didn't train. Don't mean I don't need training. But I'm very good at what I do. I believe in myself wholeheartedly, and I will, again, I respect the person giving me the opportunity. So I cannot disrespect myself in getting this opportunity. They'll give you the chance, man. You know, we could have gave it to Omar Epps, but we give it. We will see what you can do, man. Again, you think you can really? Yes, don't worry about that. Watch this. You know, because the harder you come, the better I do. You know, when I'm on set with somebody, I like to be pushed and be pushed. So I want to be on set with some serious hardcore veterans that'll push me into having to be great or get kicked off the set. You know what I'm saying? Either you great or you gotta go because you suck. I want to be on set with them cats. And so that's where the goal is. That's the goal.
Right. I feel you on that. Like, I would love to see you do more movies and everything. I definitely, because all those shows you listed, they're really good. I can definitely see you on BMF, just playing, bringing it, just coming in and whatever character they bring in. Yeah, I definitely see you on that show because that show is really good. It's based on like a true story, but it's a really good really good show. I watch it now, so you'll really make like a new good character. And they bring in with all those shows, even Carl Weber's The Family Business. You'll really be good over there as well. So either way, wherever you go. Trust me, you'll really be good for those shows. Even the ones I just named, BMF or Carl Weathers, Family Business. I really would see you doing those two shows. Just bringing in a whole new character, especially for a family of Carl Weathers, The Family Business. You can play another Duncan. That's their last name, the Duncan, the Duncan family. And they just brought in a new character. So I could definitely, Sheila E., they just brought in. So I could definitely, she can get on. I could definitely see Damion Hall coming in as the new Duncan. So yeah, that show was filled up with everything. But yeah, so she can get on. You can get on. So I can't wait.
Absolutely. To see everybody, I know you got executive producers. You got casting agents that watch your joint. You got everybody watching your joint.
Yeah.
Listen, y'all already know how I get down. Y'all know Damion is loved by people. But Damion is serious about his acting thing. So whatever y'all got going on, you heard it here first. She got the plug. No, the plug is get me on Family Business. Get me on some of those Tyler Perry get downs. You know what I'm saying? Like, and let me show the world the other side of who I really am. You know what I'm saying? I consider myself a natural. You know what I'm saying? It's like it comes easy. I got a lot of other films that's coming. I got a lot of scripts that got sent to me. I'm just taking it slow and gonna do what I gotta do to polish and sharpen and be with people that can sharpen me. And make me better at what I do, because every movie I just want to get better and better and better and better. And I'm excited about what this next phase is going to be, because I'm really trying to be by that summer of next year. I'm trying to be that other cat that you see in everything. Like, you know, and they say, no, we got to get Damion. Because Damion gives us exactly what we get. He's on point. He know his character. He does his lines, and he's out. We shoot. We stay on time, and we get out of it. That's me. Let's make it happen.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. There's something an artist taught me in one of the interviews. Believe in yourself. Yes, that's what I do. Believe in yourself. Yes, yes, yes. Unless I know I got producers, any agents, everybody be watching the show. Go get Mr. Damion Hall for them TV shows and put him in there. Come on now. He right here. He want to. Let him, put him in there. Get Damion. Now, Damion, what would you say what is the next chapter for Damion Hall?
The next chapter is like I said, movies and mm-hmm. creating content as well. And I'm doing a new album. So I'm hitting mm-hmm. markets simultaneous. And we never know what God's plan is. You know, I might get inside of a movie or one of these television shows and series, and it's mm-hmm. and it's over, ticked off, boom. Don't mean you're not gonna see me doing music, because I'm also doing my new album right now. And it's coming out very mm-hmm. well. So you're gonna see that. I don't know which one gonna come first. This movie was my last movie I shot and the first movie to be premiered. So I'm excited about what's next for Damion. And I'm also humbled that my fans still support me and still rah-rah and cheer for me, like to be great. Just like you said, you know what I'm saying? Give them opportunity, put them on Family Business. It's like, people don't have to say that. You know, and it's not something that you say for everybody, right? But one thing I know about myself, whatever I put my mind to do, or whatever I set forth to do, I never have any regrets on it, because I do my best. It's like all these things that y'all seeing, I'm seeing a bunch of different looks and stuff that y'all putting up on these screens. I have no regrets on any vibe, any move, how anything you see, my body's on point. How I move is on point. Like, I give you what you came, what you drove to the venue to see. I'm giving it to you.
Mm-hmm.
We give it.
There you go, right there. Yes.
Yeah. You know, we having a lot of fun doing what we do. And as Damion Hall, my brand, the D Hall Experience. Wait till mm-hmm. I give you that. You know, you get bits and pieces of it when you see the guy show, when you see me on stage with myself, and when you hear me do interviews. That's Damion. That's not me, Aaron, and Teddy here doing an interview together. I'm giving you Damion. So you're getting to understand how I am, and to like or dislike me is up to you. But I'm giving you me. So when it comes down mm-hmm. to my music, to me being on that television set or on that screen, I can only hope that you enjoy it as much as I enjoy trying to present that character to you, trying to present these songs to you, trying to present my image to you. You know, I just do my best to make sure I don't disappoint. And 9 times out of 10, I don't. So we'll see. But the future, to God be the glory for everything that he has allowed me to be able to do, to the fans from 88 to now that stood by and have respect for what we presented as a group, as Guy, as individuals, as Teddy doing Blackstreet, Aaron doing his individual, me doing my Straight to the Point album. I love y'all, because without y'all, there is no me. But I'm telling you, when I come, I'm coming hard. I'm coming. So people gonna be going home like, damn, this month, who knew this guy? Who gave him the opportunity? Like, some people don't want a person like me to really shine, because if I come out and get that opportunity for real, it's over, bro. It's over. And trust, it's gonna be talked about, because I don't half-ass anything that I do. I just don't. When I really come out and I'm ready to present it, it's never half-assed. Mm-hmm. Even when I cook. If I ever cook for a female and I know how to cook, I'm not half-assing it. You're going to go, you cook this? This is fantastic. And while you finish eating, you like, I got to give you some loving now, because you just made my tummy all nice and happy. I got to give you this loving. And, you know, it's what it is, because now I'm giving you the the whole spectrum. For whatever reason, you said hello to me, be it because you thought I had a great personality, be it because I was the one guy you always wanted to get with, and then you realize it's not about guy now, it's about the individual. And then you say, man, he's funny, he's nice, he's caring, he can cook, he makes me laugh, he trained me. Hey, I don't know, who else do you want? Come on now. So, you know, I say to all men out there, man, be the best you can be, but be truthful to the lady that you are with. Don't BS her half to death. You know, present who you are so that she have the opportunity to choose whether or not she want to fuck with you or not.
Yes, well said. What do you want your legacy to be?
That you know, I gave my best. And I literally loved the best way I knew how to love. I taught the best way I knew how to teach. I was who you met. And the presentation of who I presented was the true me. I never want nobody to say, well, this motherfucker, I ain't know this motherfucker. This. And when if I died, you go, he was like, so he was lying all the time? Nah, that I spoke my truth. I lived my truth. And I was who I presented. I mean, and that encompasses everything. As a father, as a brother, as a grandfather, as an uncle, as a godfather, as a leader, as a teacher, as an artist, as a creator, and as a performer. You know what I'm saying? I gave my best and I presented exactly who I was in those different categories and how I wanted to be presented. And I have no regrets on that. That I live without regret.
Well, all right. That's what I'm talking about. Yes. Well, Damion, that's the end of that interview. We're done. But what I do now with artists is I do ask you 10 easy, quick. If you ever seen Family Feud, Steve Harvey, I ask 10 easy questions real quick, the 1 minute, and Tallboy's going to get the timer ready, and you'll go in there, come real quick. So you got to just whatever comes to mind. It's real fun. We're going to have some fun. We're about to have, this is the fun part of the segment, but that portion is done. You ready, Tallboy? All right. I can't see the time. Are we ready or what? Let me go ahead and ask him.
You good?
All right. Okay. Favorite ice cream?
Strawberry.
Favorite dish?
Honey chicken wings with rice.
Favorite
and
movie? All right. Favorite movie?
Favorite movie is Godfather.
Favorite comedian?
My favorite comedian, was Cat Williams.
A favorite love song?
Don and Nikki.
Favorite color?
Blue.
Favorite sunrise or sunset?
Say what?
Sunrise or sunset?
Sunset.
Chicken or ribs?
Chicken.
Grits with salt or grits with sugar?
Grits with sugar and butter.
Name the artist and group you would like to see come on Old School Tuesday Turn Up.
New Edition.
Artists. Hey, artists.
Oh, artist. Tay.
Tay. Oh, okay. All right, that's what I'm talking about. Listen, let me ask you. There was one question I wanted to ask. Have they DJ Cassidy called for you guys to come do Pass the Mic yet? Are you willing to do that? Because everybody else is doing it and I'm like, where's Guy at? I'm gonna see Guy do theirs.
He didn't call me, he called Teddy did it. He called Aaron, mm-hmm. who didn't do it. He didn't call Damion, and he didn't call us as a trio. So, no, DJ Cassidy didn't call me. He did a New Jack segment, mm-hmm. called Teddy. Mm-hmm. People called me. People were DMing me going, why the hell Teddy's on there and you not on there? And he's saying, nigga, you supposed to be. I was like, yo, he didn't call me. I guess I'm the member he don't know. I don't know. You know what I mean? That's fine. You know, it's what it that's is. Wrong, you know man. What I mean?
Right. That's right. Yeah. Come on, Cassie. Hey, Top Boy, you want to come in and ask any question? Damion, I just want to thank you for being on the show. Let me ask you, though, when you think of Old School Tuesday Turnup, what do you think of?
You know what I mean? I think Old School Tuesday Turnup, you know, you got to think about what old school artists truly turned it up in his time or her time or their time that can really add to what it is you're doing. Old school turn up, you gotta have turn up artists that really knew how to turn up back at that time. They really knew how to turn that shit up. You know what I'm saying? Yes. You know, everybody don't know how to turn up and did not know how to turn up. But some people know how to turn up, whether it was the after party, whether it was the pre-party, whether it was on that stage, yes. Whether it was how they are as individuals, that's the turn up. Like Nick, he might not turn up on stage, but when he turned up at his house, oh, you've been to his house party? Turned up! Right? It all depends. Like, you know, I'm a turn up. People that know Damion, when they came to my party, it was turn up city. You come on that stage, it's turn up time. You know what I'm saying? You see me on that red carpet, I'm dressed up, I'm turning it up. So it's what it is. You know, you gotta have people that really know how to turn up in some capacity.
Yes. And I just, like I said, that's what I'm talking about. Damion, thank you for being here. I know you and I were communicating back and forth on IG, trying to get you here. And when you finally, by the grace of God, you came and you turned up for us tonight. And we had fun, even though the devil tried to come in and stop. One lady even said, when we show you shirtless, she was like, that's what stopped the streaming, right? That's when it cut off. It said suspended, like stop. And I was sitting there the whole time
look.
That's what stopped the streaming. Like,
my thing is 50 and fit, right? And I do believe, like, as you see, you know, I don't sit around. I don't play the game. Like, I believe that whatever body you have, however your body is, you got to make it the best you possibly can. That was, wow. That was back in that picture. Was in 1998. That picture was 98. So you know, yes. I believe that you gotta be the best person that you possibly could be. I believe in working out and being healthy and making sure that I live the life at 53 that I put some of these young cats and most people I do put to shame because my body do look like my photos. And I don't play around with that. You know what I'm saying? Like, it ain't nothing made up on my body. It is what it is. I put the time in. I don't lift as much as I should lift, but I try to do at least 300 push-ups every day, no matter what. Get your push-ups in. I tell everybody too, get your push-ups in. Ladies, you know, you got the little, you know, pot bellies and stuff like that. You put the wrap on, fellas too, and go and walk. Even if you don't like working out, go walk. Just walk up different terrains though. Don't just walk around flat. Walk up different terrains. Up, down, around, up, around, down. And just get your walk on, but walk right. Walk rightfully. Everything about me is focus plus form equals fitness. Right? Those are my three ups, how I train people. And it's not about just doing something. People just do. Well, I worked out today, but you worked out wrong. Your whole workout was wrong. Your shoulder was like this. You was walking like this. You wasn't walking upright where your body was done. You wasn't twisting your hips correctly. So this is how I train so that you can get your results faster than later. I get results when I train. You're going to see the results.
Yes, that's what I'm talking. I know I'll be seeing you on Instagram. You be buffing to the, I'll be like, oh my God, he's hitting it. I'll be like, he makes me want to go to gym, all right? You be doing your thing though. But would you like to, you be doing your thing. I think in one of your posts, there was a Night to Remember song was playing. You come down like the Soul Train, like you was dancing in there. I'm like, that's what I'm talking about. He don't miss a beat. Yes, you know, if I ever, hopefully by the grace of God next year, I get to, you owe me a dance because I love to dance. I'm right here in Kansas City, Kansas. Speaking of Kansas, have you been here? Have you been here before? Or you haven't been here in a long time?
No, we came to Kansas. We were supposed to do a show, and during the time, this was in 2018. We were supposed to do a show. And then when we got there, it was us, Keep Sweat. And when we got there, a hurricane came. And we were like, oh, hell the fuck no, we're not doing that. So we, didn't do the show, but we went to the spot. Everybody was going, went to the spot just so we can say hi to people that would stay there, which is weird. I'm amazed that people even stayed, but went and we said hi. We said we'll come back and do a show. We have not been in Kansas City since. But hopefully we'll come back there one day in life again and do a show, or you'll see Damion's show out there.
That's what I'm talking about. You know, if you're coming to my hometown, Kansas City, you know, you got to hit me up. Priscilla, hey, I'm in your town. You know, I'm going to be right there.
Absolutely. You know. You gonna be my guest right there, right by my side, coming through the whole get down of everything.
Just that's what I'm out. Talking about. That's what I'm talking about. You sitting there dancing. Speaking of dancing, that theme song in the beginning, you know, has everybody, would you like to, you know, put a little spin to it and sing a little something to go with that song, or you want to come up, would you like to sing the, for us to come out of here? How would you, what you want to do? Or should we play the song for you so you can hear?
Let me tell you what's going on with me right now, just for real. Mm-hmm. I have a, and this is how truthful I am, I don't know what it is in my left ass cheek, right? I can't even walk, that's why I'm sitting down like this and I'm chilling, because I can't even walk. And my voice has been like, I don't know what's been going on. Like they said there was a cough going on and whatever. But if you know, I'll sing a little line or something. Maybe if I can sing over this thing. But what song you want me to sing?
You can sing whatever you want. A little line of whatever, so the ladies can hear you sing. You can sing whatever you want. Just bless us with the song, and we gonna get up out of here. Whatever you want.
I'm let you. What is that? Are
you going to be singing on top of that? Hey. I can't sing on top of that. you can be like, we turning up old school Tuesday, turn up, but whatever.
I might do a theme song for you. Let's talk about that offline.
We'll talk about that offline. I got you. But Damion, let me go ahead and get up out of here. Stay right there. And we're going to talk out of here, you know, behind the show. But let me say goodbye. Hold on. Where can your fans catch you? Where can they catch you? We're on social media. Where can they catch you at for the ones who are watching, who want to come see you?
You can catch me on Twitter, Damion Hall _ guy. Also the same mm-hmm. thing on IG, Damion Hall _ guy. And on Facebook, I am Damion Hall with the no shirt on, looking all the same picture.
Oiled up.
On Facebook. You know, oiled and greased up. But I'm on IG most times. I'm on anything. I'm on IG. I'm also Damion Hall on Clubhouse. I've been on there, but I got to start being more active on certain things, and I will in 2022. But I had to get some things situated for 2021 so that I know exactly where the world is going, where life is going, because everything has changed. You know, we all know that the world is different now. Things have changed now, and a lot of people are fearful and nervous, and, you know, they're trying to change the way that we move in our life. And I don't adhere to certain things, but you know, I'm just trying to figure things out to make sure that life and family and everything goes correct. But I also want to give love to my fans more in 2022, and I'm about to. So y'all get ready for that.
All right. Well, all right. That's what I'm talking about. Yes, Tom, you want to say something real quick?
You had a fan that, or one of the family members asked, would you do a reality show, a music-inspired one like Making the Band? That was a question that was posed that you didn't see earlier.
I would do a reality show, you know what I'm saying? I got my people now trying to get me to host some shows. You know, Damion, you should be a host. You should be on The Voices, The Voice or something like that, like as one of the judges or something like that. But I would do a reality show. Not really Making the Band. If I was one of the judges or something, yes. But me being on there to be part of a band, no, I would not. But I would do a reality show. We're actually thinking about one now. But I'm gonna see, you know, because you know my reality and other people's reality might be a little bit different, right? But I do think that getting on a reality show can give you a platform to be on numerous different things once people see you and if you're a likable character, because everything is about the character. And I think I'm a likable character. So it was all good. Yes, I would be on TV.
Another question was, do you have a clothing line?
I am coming out with a clothing line in 2022. Yes. I can't really say the name of it yet. It's a very unique name. It's very catchy. It's very clever. Things I do, I like it to be clever. It's clever. What the words stand for, what the letters stand for. But the style, for everybody to know me, like I do stuff like this, but this is not mine. But it'll have some form of stuff like this and a lot of different mixed fabrics. I'm doing a lot of mixed fabrics. I do a lot of European looking type stuff when I design. I don't like designing everything just being, oh, that's a t-shirt. Oh, with a fake one. I'm coming with a line. Y'all just get ready. I'm coming out. I'm going to start with t-shirts first so people, the buzz can start. But even my t-shirt's going to be a little bit different.
Then I think the last question that the family, Monica Kelly said, who inspired I Miss You? And was it based on a true event in the video?
Well, and yes, it was inspired. Aaron and I think, I want to say Lainey Stewart, but I'm not quite sure. So forgive me, whoever's watching this. It wasn't Lainey, it was me, Damion. But that was Aaron's song. That wasn't inspired by a real event, and which allowed him to sing it the way that he sung it, because it came from a real place.
And shout out to Thea Wilson. She says that she was drunk tonight and have finally made it to the house. She was listening all the way and loved me, Hall's interview. That's what she said as the comment. So shout out to, I don't know what she was drinking, why the dark, but you know, we're gonna give her some love on that one. The question I have for you, because of this pandemic, I know you've done a lot of interviews. Well, you said you didn't do a lot of them, but as far as the ones that you've done, as opposed to the radio interviews before the pandemic, how do you like the live streaming aspect of it, being able to interact with people like Priscilla or, you know, somebody else that's a guest host?
I think it's cool. I think everybody became a interviewer, right, during this pandemic. Like, people either became a fucking DJ or became some psychologist or somebody that thought that they can finally get their thing up. And some of them are very good. And some of them, I think, who are you interviewing, right? So that's why I said no to a lot of people. And I said yes, Priscilla, because I watched certain things that she done, and I just felt her personality. Because I really don't, you know, like, for me, it's like, who are you reaching? Why are you doing this? And is there substance in what you're doing, right? And for me, it has to be that, because anybody that listens to any of my interviews, you go on YouTube, you see any of my interviews, my Vlad interview, my interview with April Mason, my interview with my girl, Sherelle. I talk real. I talk real stuff. I talk that stuff that people wish they can say and they won't say because they figure they're going to lose a girl or lose their fan base or something. I speak truth. And I like it when I can talk and see a person, because basically people that interview me, one time or the other, are fans of me, number one. Number two, they were fans of Guy, and now they have a platform of their own. And now they, you know, they're starting to do something for themselves that's gonna better themselves or create income or create another avenue for them to be able to do something that they always loved to do and didn't do it before because they were just going to work. Now this pandemic allowed people to open up different doors and become their own producers of their own show, creating their own content. And so I kind of respect that. I like seeing people, because, you know, I did an interview with two cats out of Washington, and they created a whole big thing about me and Blackstreet. It was huge. It went viral. And I told them, you would never get another interview from me ever in your life, that y'all a bunch of fuckboys. You know what I'm saying? Even though it was a girl and a guy. I said, you would never get an interview from me. a day in your life again. It just it never happened. Because they use snippets of the interview to create discord. And I don't do that. You know what I'm saying? And people that listen to the whole interview say, oh, we got why you said that. Because I don't ever sugarcoat what I say. Because I don't fear no guy, no Nick, no nobody. I don't fear nobody. When I say it in your face. Look you straight in your eye and say what I said. So the fact that they was trying to manipulate the interview made me very upset. So I'm very cautious. And if I get on an interview and I see somebody trying to take it someplace, I'll end the interview. I don't care about your interview. I don't care about your platform. I'll just end the interview. The interview is over now. So, you know, but that's me. You know? So I like Priscilla. And that's why I'm here doing this thing now and Turnup Tuesday.
What have you?
Thank you.
What have you learned from the pandemic? What was the one lesson that you took out of this pandemic?
You know, that you have to, in order to understand this agenda that is happening, you had no choice but to step into your God self, for those that did. That really step into your God self to open up and change your mindset, because your outcome is definitely going to change whether you wanted to change or not. The outcome of the life that you led before 2020 was going to change with or without you changing your mindset. In order to change with the agenda and to understand this vaccinated, unvaccinated, this FDA, not FDA, this come outside, stay inside agenda, you can't go to work unless you have this, and you can't do this unless you have that. You can't see your mama, your daddy, your aunt, uncle, your grandparents unless you have this. You have to change your mindset. So during the pandemic, you know, I was always a thinker's thinker. Right. I was always a deep thinker, for those that know me. I was always a teacher. So all this did was allow everything I was teaching before to actually be seen and manifested. For those that want to close their eyes to it, that's on them. But for me, it just opened up. It tore down the curtain. And Trump started that. I won't go into a political thing right now, but Trump went into the White House and tore down and opened up the White House so you can see the mess that it really is. And for those that really believe that Biden and Kamala was some fucking savior, I pray to God that y'all are studying what's happening and you waking up, because you have to wake up your third eye. For those that say third eye, I say my God self. You have to, it woke me up. I think a lot of people are walking around completely ridiculous zombies right now because they choose to move in fear and to believe in something because they didn't study themselves to know anything. They just became followers. And I personally was never a follower, never followed anything. I don't follow rules in any capacity. And I believe in knowing what God has for me, and that's that. And some people will never agree with that, and I personally don't care, you know. So it taught me to be more of me.
There it is.
There it is. Yes, yes. Thank you, Damion, for coming on here and being with us, having fun, turning up with us, allowing us to just interact with the audience and everything. I'm sorry about what happened earlier and everything. We just kept going. We just kept the party going because that's just how I am. I'm glad you was here. That's what this show is about. Just coming on here, allowing artists to be themselves. Just have fun and just turn up. That's what it's all about. Turning up on Tuesdays with Miss Watley.
Turning up Tuesdays. All
right. That's what I'm talking about. But we're going to sit here. Damion, hold on. Stay right there. Let me end this real quick. I want to thank you all for turning up, for sitting here watching the interview with the one and only Mr. Damion Hall. Please catch him on his IG. You have Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. You can find Damion Hall anywhere because I follow him like a whatever he's doing, I'm right there watching you, Damion. He knows. But I want to thank you all for sitting here watching. Thank you to the Hour Girls for watching. Also, you know, if you guys donate to the show, you know, my Cash App is under money sign is Watley05. You guys get the picture with me, with the artist, along with the Old School Tuesday Turn Up earrings and a little special note for thank you for the donation and everything. Until next time, you guys, I'll be back next month with a whole nother 90s interview. We're going to girl group route. That's where we're going. But I can't tell you guys. I'm going to keep that a big secret. But until then, you guys enjoy your Tuesday night. Enjoy the rest of your week, and thank you all for tuning in to Miss Watley Presents Old School Tuesday Turn Up. Damion, real quick, let's go ahead and dance on up out of here a little bit. Top Boy, play the music. Let's turn up. Hey.
I wasn't ready, but okay, give me one second. I wasn't ready for the music, but hold on.
I like to catch him off guard. Here we go. Hey. Damien, remember this? Yeah.